You heard that I played tennis, and I know a lot of you are thinking, okay, I see your hands and your legs. How well do you play tennis? Well, during my career, I played John McEnroe, and don't be too impressed, because I want to tell you what I learned playing John McEnroe. Positive attitude does not work every time. That's what I learned. I slipped my finger in between the space that you see. When I first started playing, I used a Wilson T2000. Some people call this a coincidence. I think it was providence. Walked into a tennis store, my finger slipped into the throat of the racket and it got stuck. And that's how I began to play tennis, because I could control the racket with one hand. Even though I wore an artificial leg, I have fairly good mobility. In fact, I remember playing this gentleman one time, and throughout the entire match, I wore long warm-up pants. My opponent didn't realize until the match was over that I wore an artificial leg. He took the loss a lot harder then. Playing tennis helped me understand the difference between fear and anxiety. Often we think the words are synonymous, but not by definition. Fear is tied to circumstance. Fight or flight response is a good example of how fear actually keeps us out of harm's way. If we're going to change what's possible, achieve the impossible, in a changing environment, we're going to face a bit of fear. Fear is tied to something real. But anxiety, I believe, is what holds us back. Definition of anxiety is the anticipation of a negative event, whether it occurs or not. Fear tied to circumstance, anxiety to imagination.
Look into
the future. If we can add this next ingredient, the ingredient is lagniappe. Lagniappe. It's a French Cajun word. Let me tell you how I became aware of it when I was shopping in southern Louisiana. I was looking at the men's suits. 42 regular, 42 long, 42 short. They didn't have my size. I wore a 42 strange. It wasn't on the rack. So this gentleman approaches me. Sir, notice you were looking at the suits, hoping I might assist you in some way in finding just the right suit for you. Wow, was I impressed. I said, well, thank you so much. I really appreciate your help, but I'm not buying a suit today. I'm just looking. He said, sir, may I ask why? And I said, well, since you ask, I just want to be up front. It's because of the alterations. You probably notice when you approach me, my arms are shorter than normal. So it's going to require such extensive alteration. I just don't believe that I'll be buying a suit, but I thank you so much for your help. He turns to me. Sir, I'm sure you're aware that most athletic men have that problem. Right? I really like this guy. I did. I mean, I wanted to continue our conversation. I said, could you repeat that one more time? Sure, heard you clearly. He said, well, when you have an athletic build like you obviously do, it's going to require alteration for that suit to fit properly. I looked at him. I said, you're absolutely right. I don't know what I was thinking. But I tell you what, I'll take my athletic body right over to that mirror. So here I am, standing in front of a three-way mirror. He brings over a jacket. I tried on, the arms are a little long, but I remember thinking, that's no big deal. Those could be altered. So I vacillated back and forth. Should I purchase a suit or shouldn't I? I decided that I didn't want to make a firm commitment myself. I wanted to check with him. Do you know why? It's not every day you work with an expert in athletic men clothing. I wasn't going to pass up this opportunity. So I said, is this the type of suit that an athletic guy like me should be wearing? He said, oh, yes, sir. In fact, there's several others here in the rack that you must have as well. I bought them all. And I felt so good about it. Dillard's Department Store, Baton Rouge, Louisiana, has a sign. Sign says, never neglect the lagniappe.